Hi, everybody. Welcome to Masters of Mash. My name is Pimpdaddysupreme. Today we have a GYBO legend, a unapologetically raw and visceral mashup duo out of the UK. We're going to dive deep into what makes them so special. And for me, this is one of those penultimate mashup early era groups that really, you know, set the bar for that, again, that early stage of mashups. Like when you think of Too Many DJs and Soul Wax and stuff like that, they have this sense about them that allows for experimentation and an even more extreme genre clash, things like, you know, deeper digs into your crates, you know. And and anyway, well, without further ado, I'm going to bring these guys on. One other thing real quick. Honestly, being a part of the mashup scene with GYBO and whatnot back in the day, usually, you know, other than the handful of pictures you might be able to see, you only interact with these people with other mashup artists with their user handle. And so with the name Pilchard, many of us and many people still only think that Pilchard is one person, which actually it turns out is a duo. So today we peel back the tin lid of the sardine can and find out that sardines aren't exactly what this is. Pilchards are a little bit larger and they're a little bit older. So here we are, guys. Scott Cairo, Tony Crackburn, how are we doing?
Hi. Yeah,
I'm wonderful. Good, I'm having to rearrange this live real quick. Skype has a tendency to try to resize windows on you in the middle of an interview. So, where are we broadcasting from today? I'm assuming, Scott, are you still in London? You're in Reading.
I'm in Reading.
And then Tony, where are you?
Reading. Yeah.
Where was that?
It's the same as Reading. It's the same as Reading, but it's got a power station.
Completely opposite of Reading. It's very, very quiet. It's a nice little village. Nothing happens here. I quite like it. Nothing happens here. Like,
really?
George Harrison lives
there. He's still alive.
He's still alive.
He fucking does.
Tell you what, before we go on, right? I see Mandalay was responsible for finding that fucking drug that solved all that coronavirus problems. I'll tell you why, because the dextrohedral redrin or whatever, the name of that drug was found in an Oxford hospital like a week ago. Now, they have found no cure for the coronavirus up to a week ago. Can you turn the fucking that turn down? Thanks, darling. And they found no cure for the virus. And I walked in there with a broken ankle last week, and I sprinkled fairy dust in the doctor's hair, and they came up with the cure for the coronavirus. And I tell you what, if you Google it, the cure for coronavirus is like literally out of my door, around the corner. So, yeah, you can call me God.
If you can't pronounce it, you shouldn't be taking it.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you heard it here first. The cure for the coronavirus
found by
Tony Crackburn of Pilchard.
It's very hard to say and very hard to take. And
right. Scott, I get it.
If you can't
let's go ahead and dive into this interview, shall we? First of all, I'm going to start with you, Scott.
Yeah.
Sure. Since you are closest to me on the screen here.
Uh-oh.
Why don't you tell me what year and where you were born?
I was born in 1963. I was brought up as a mod.
1963.
Uh-huh.
And where were you? Where were you born?
Sake.
Battersea. Okay. And you only lived there for how long? First 17 years? How long did you live there?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I lived there till I was about 17, and I got brought to this horrible, horrible school in Reading, which they did this thing called rugby. And I, what? rugby.
So Scott, tell me,
like you people come and just like trip right. you over as part of a game. Fuck that.
So ping pong is much safer for sure. So Scott, tell me about your parents, or do you have any brothers or siblings that might have introduced you to music, or you know, helped you shape your musical love?
Okay, my father was heavily into Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath and Pink Floyd, and just like basically playing music much too loud when I was trying to sleep. Which I loved, you know, it was okay, but
it was annoying. Your dad was pissing you off.
Yeah. And he was, and the reason he was pissing me off was because he wanted me to get up so I'd go and mow the fucking lawn.
Right, right. So I mean, there's the question: is that what was that something that pushed you away from, say, classic rock? You know, Led Zeppelin, Pink Floyd, stuff like that. What did you wind up listening to?
No, it drew me in. It drew me into it because I. At a very early age, I learned the structures and the beats and the progressions of what made Black Sabbath, Black Sabbath.
Right.
Without actually knowing anything about it. And it was only Spike that sort of like connected me to realizing how it all fitted together.
Let's talk to Tony about that real quick.
Does that make any sense?
So Tony, tell me where and when were you born? Yeah.
Where was I born? I was born in a place called Taplow, which is like on the outskirts of a place called Maidenhead, which is like some like little horrible little Tory town on the outskirts of Slough, which was famous for something called The Office, which you probably know over in America. And Taplow, what really happened there? Really, I went to an all boys school. Wanted to go to an all girls school, really, as you do. But yeah, my older brothers didn't do very well at their school, so they like chucked me into this all boys school. It didn't work out very well, and but. You know, my mum and dad, they were quite cool. They played me some pretty cool music. Harry Belafonte and Burt Bacharach and Kraftwerk, believe it or not. My dad played me Kraftwerk.
That sounds like quite the palette. Was there any music that you didn't like, that you just like specifically was just like, this was not your thing?
Not really. But yeah, Rod Stewart. Rod Stewart's a cunt. My brother, my big brother, Brian.
No, he's not.
No, he is. Rod Stewart's a cunt. My big brother, he would go out to like, because Studio 54 just, can you get that fucking dog out now? Thank you. Sorry. But Cleo, can you please quiet down?
That'd be nice.
Please.
That's nice.
Now, she knows I'm joking. So, Rod Stewart's a cunt, basically. My brother would play. My brother would play me Peggy Way and stuff like that. And I hated it, really. But I loved all the disco stuff that he was bringing home, like Donna Summer and stuff like that. So it was like a sort of mixture of that. And then my other brother would play me Frank Zappa and Public Image and stuff like that. And I quite like
that. So now you said you were born right like outside of Maidenhead. And when did you move to Reading? Or did you move to Reading? Or did you just go to school there?
I just went to school in Maidenhead. But I moved to Reading when I was kind of about 19, 20. But when I moved out of home, I moved out home when I was 17. I moved in with like seven Scottish mad musician-stroke chef types. And they kind of...
Don't tell that story, Spike.
They kind of gave me my sort of grounding into life, really, because they're all on the dole. And you got to remember, they came from Scotland. There was like no fucking jobs up there at the time. So they all piled down to fucking Reading. Oh, sorry, down to Maidenhead to get jobs, like in the catering industry. So I learned how to make a meal out of an onion and a packet of lentils. And
I've
also
just got there for a pee.
Play like two chords on a guitar.
Right. So there's the thing. It's so, yeah, it was 1984. You left school. Somewhere around that time period is when you first met Scott here. When did you meet? When did you two meet, really?
I met Scott. So, yeah, when I moved out home, so I was 17, and then I was moving with like Scottish blokes. And then my brother was a huge influence on my life at that time. And he was mixing with a load of like older people. I mean, when you're like a 15, 16 year old kid, and there's like sort of 22, 23 year olds, like older people around you, like into music, it's quite sort of, wow, this is cool, you know? So, and Jim was part of that crew, as is Steve Howard, which we'll get into later in the story. And, but when I first met Jim, he was like the coolest guy in town. He like was the snappiest dresser, like he'd wear like tartan suits and he'd have his hair red. He looked like a sort of male version of Vivian Westwood, you know? I was actually quite handsome when I was younger. I looked like Andrew Ridgeley, but I looked like a cunt. I was like handsome, but I wanted to look like Jim, who looked geeky and like a bit weird, but didn't quite do it, you know what I mean? So yeah. I looked up to Jim, you know, in terms of fashion and stuff, you know.
Now, it's funny. It's like when I talked to you guys on Sunday as part of the pre-interview, this part of the story is amazing. Like, you guys met, I'm assuming, you know, again, Scott moved to Reading and got forced to go to this really shitty school. And I'm assuming he started hanging out with those people that, you know, then bumped him into you. At what point, because, I mean, supposedly in 1985, you guys were already DJing house parties together. At what point did you guys decide to start listening to music together, have that musical discussion, and really become kind of party DJs together?
you got me there.
Well, no, good question. Okay, so you got to remember, so when me and Jim first kind of met, which would have been 1984, 1985, that was a really bleak time for music, generally. I mean, you had like Wham and the Human League and Ultravox and Gary, all the new romantic stuff, but there was no place to really go out and have a good time, because me and Jim and my bunch of mates at the time, my brother and Steve Howard, we kind of like things a little bit harder. We were listening to things like Cabaret Voltaire and Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds and stuff like that. But there was no disco, inverted commas, to go to.
Ministry.
Well, remember at that time, Ministry was doing more synth poppy kind of stuff.
Yeah. So there was nothing
like
Revolting Cox at the time, wasn't it?
So we had Revolting Cox, you had Cabaret Voltaire, you had things like 23 Skidoo, you had Ministry, and that was the Throbbing Gristle, that sort of thing going on.
Devo.
But that was it, but there was no disco. Then the whole On You Sound thing sort of came into fruition with Gary Clare and the Tackhead Sound System, and we kind of latched onto that. And you got to remember, this was 1987, and this was just before Acid House broke. So Acid House broke over in America, and they were doing all their pills and stuff, but over in England, we had no discos, and Gary Clale and the On You Sound Boys were the first things like, we've got a disco here that, you know, that we can go out and listen to, you know, because we didn't fit in with the Ultravox and the fucking Duran Durans and the Human League. We didn't fit into that crowd. So that was like a godsend to us, and it was fucking hard. And, you know, when you get your own little gang, and, you know, it's like your own little club and nobody's ever heard of it. And it was cool. You know, there's fucking queues around the block for it. And it was fucking hard. You came out, your head was mangled. Fucking
that's
mangled.
Amazing.
And
so
we loved it.
There's the other thing. It's like you're talking about, like, you know, getting together, looking for something a little bit more visceral, like, you know, Throbbing Gristle and stuff like that. And, you know, Revco, early industrial music. But your DJ group from 1985 was called what was it called? The No Request Sound System or No Request DJs? What was that?
No Request Sound System.
And you weren't just doing like, you know, hard industrial or like, you know, at early acid house stuff like that. You were literally doing, taking your own records, and I'm assuming these are your own records, like from like lounge records and old vocalists from like the 50s and 60s, and you know, things like the Osmonds, and you know, and who else? Like
Crazy Horses, man.
I tell you what, guys, right? To give you an example, right? Yeah, you're absolutely right there. So we would go out, when we used to go out DJing at parties, we'd have a bag of records with some like sort of disco tunes and that. But if we wanted to fucking put in some Frank Sinatra or something in there, I'd have David Essex in my fucking collection. Right? I'd have the Beatles in my collection. I'd have, and then shit like this, like Instruments in Gold, like Easy Listening, right? And I'd have a bit of fucking New Order. And I'd have a bit of James Last. Bit of James Last. So we would try and mix all these records together, bearing in mind that SL12s were not even born then. We were trying to mix all these tracks together with the bare minimal technical abilities, you know, of that era. So it was fucking hard, you know? It was hard. Moonlight and Roses. I can go on.
Well, I mean, I think that that's amazing that at the time, you know, here it is mid 80s and you're really going for this super diverse mix, trying to pair things that, I guess were ironic at the time. Was there irony in the reason that you were doing this, or were you like,
No, there's no irony at all.
There's
no fucking irony, man. I just wanted to mix Easy Listening with hard beats. I loved it. I wanted to hear it. There's no irony at all. Well, there might have been with you, but not me. Everybody else was mixing two cute little disco tracks together. I wanted to wear Frank Sinatra
right.
beat.
And, you know, honestly, like there were a lot of.
Yeah. Okay. He's got it.
There were a lot of people that were.
That's exactly.
I would say there's a lot
from.
Of people. I'm definitely wrong. There were a handful of people like Steinsky and whatnot that were taking these disparate sources and mixing them together, and more stuff in the sound collage era where it was like mixing some really strange things apart. But there were also a handful of DJs here and there like that were commercial that would like throw in weird things like theme songs to the Brady Bunch and stuff like that around that time period, just for a laugh, you know. But again, you're saying that like what you were doing, at least on your side, Tony, was serious. It was heartfelt.
Completely heartfelt, yeah, completely. Because I had I grew up with the EC listening side of things, with the Bacharach stuff. And yeah, I just felt at that time, you know, it's growing up as a kid, you know, it's like, wow, you know, nobody's heard that sort of thing before. Nobody was doing it. And to me, it was like a real subversive thing to do. You know, you had punk rock, which to me, punk rock, fuck that, you know, it just wasn't my thing. To me, like subversive punk was to mix disco with easy listening. That just to have two things that shouldn't belong in the
something
same
that
record.
Kind of guides what you're saying, or at least tracks with what you're saying, is something that you said that your dad said to you about the Sex Pistols. Can you elaborate on that?
My brother famously brought home Never Mind the Bollocks, which I've got in my record player. I don't need to get it out to prove it. And my dad said, no, you're not listening to that. My dad, trying to be a like conservative fucking Tory asshole, you know. But bless him, 3 years later after like the Pistols split, Public Image started, because Johnny Rotten never wanted to be in a punk band. He wanted to do a reggae band. And my dad said, he listened and said, son, if that's the same guy out of the Sex Pistols, that's got more depth. Listen to them. Listen to the dub rhythms. Listen to the space in the music. And that, and my dad really turned me on to dub reggae, which has got a huge influence on Pilchard. Really.
And you were also saying your dad was a big Kraftwerk fan. You said your dad was a big Kraftwerk fan?
Yeah, my dad had Autobahn in his record collection. I used to stare at that sleeve, you know, the bleak blue sleeve for the motorway, and also the Moody Blues. There we go. There's my copy. And my dad had the bleak blue sleeve with the white motorway and the Moody Blues, which scared the shit out of me looking at a Moody Blues cover, you know, in search of the lost chord.
So, okay, here we are, 17, that. 18 years old. You guys are DJing parties. And at the same time, you, Tony, are starting a band. Can you tell me a little bit about the band World Leaders Must Die?
World Leaders Must Die. We were going to have another pee. And hold on, I'll get the chains up. World Leaders Must Die. A bunch of angry young kids wanted to put bang the world to rights. You know, World Leaders Must Die. Huge statement. You know, and that was quite cool in those days. And we were influenced by the Joy Division and The Fall and things like that. You know, it was a short-lived little project. I was playing drums. I cut my teeth in that band, really. I was only 17, 18 at the time, and I was playing with, like, some serious musicians who were, like, sort of 28, 29, 30. So I had to, like, learn my craft very, very, very quickly.
So you were a drummer.
But that does lead up to where me and Jim started getting together.
Yeah, and you were a drummer creatively. By your musical interests.
Okay, let me stop you here. Spike is a very, very good drummer. He is Peter precise. That's why I got together with him, because I needed someone.
Well, so Scott, tell me, you were there during this time period. Did you ever get to see World Leaders Must Die perform?
Oh, yeah, they were all right.
So, I mean, tell me about this early time between you and Tony, as far as, like, you know, your friendship, how it blossomed, the parties you were doing. I'm sure you guys were partying together as well. Like, tell me a little bit in your words, like, you know, what was really going down? What was your role in, like, some of the music that he was doing? Were you just, like, watching? Were you helping out in any way?
I suppose my only input was DJing, really.
Okay, so just you guys being DJs together.
Now that... Yeah, I had a huge collection of disco records, which Spike didn't.
When did you start collecting records, Scott?
About one.
Okay. And so when you were, like, just starting to get into, like, the early grades of, you know, grade school and whatnot, when did your collection really start to pick up steam? When did you really start to get a sizable collection?
Okay, put it this way. All my records would fill a container.
I believe it.
Twice. Oh, that's my fucking record, Spike.
Watch out, Tony. You're gonna start a fight here. So anyway, Scott, the reason why I ask you about, you know, your involvement in World Leaders Must Die is that shortly after that, Tony, I guess you didn't start this, but you were in an industrial band, and Scott, you did play a role in this band. Can you, Tony, tell me about the band? And then later, Scott, can you tell me about your involvement?
Yes, but no request sound system. Ha ha! Right, this is when we start to get cooking, right? So, you know what? So you're cutting your teeth in little bands when you're little, you know, or on the DJ circuit. However, the request sound system was a kind of pivotal moment in our kind of career. So it was basically me, Jim, and the World Leaders Must Die, and my brother, John West, who was brilliant, and we would sit in my brother's studio and make these insane fucking noises through tape loops and feedback and fucking sound effects and all sorts. And I used to play electronic drums in that band. And my brother, he'd have it so loud through the mixing desk. I used to have a pair of headphones on my head and he'd tape the fucking headphones round my head with gaffer tape because it was so loud and they'd rattle off my head. And to this day, I've still got fucking ear damage. So, and No Request was, the name No Request came from DJing in a club called Cinderella Rockefellers. Now, if anybody knows Cinderella Rockefellers, you probably have one in all your towns, wherever you were in England, in the late 80s, early 90s. Everybody had a Cinderella Rockefellers. And, so all these girls that used to turn up dancing around handbags, and we used to tip up with these cassettes that we made in my brother's bedroom, this fucking industrial racket. And we used to go out thinking people would actually dance to this stuff, you know, and it was really, really rhythmical. And and these girls used to come up and say, can you play this? And we'd say, no request. And that's how the name No Request sort of
got
born.
Well, Tony, I'm glad for that. Okay. Oh, go ahead, Scott, go ahead.
Part of my involvement in that whole thing was that I was capable of making really loud sound systems.
So you strung together the speakers and the amplifiers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, this was a big thing. Like, you know, you'd build the sound system, you'd take it to the club, you'd pop your tape on and watch people either dance their ass off or scatter, right?
Mostly just like cover their ears and run away.
Right. So when you guys got done with that, you started, you know, again, passing these tapes around, but there was an industrial band that I don't know how you guys wound up in called DF118.
Spike.
Yeah. Okay, so DF118.
Nothing to do with me.
So we're busy doing our... Oh, my God. So what year is this?
This would have been like 94, okay, 96.
Yeah, 94. So we were busy doing our sound system stuff, which was like the electronic industrial noise thing. And there was a couple of other bands on the circuit at that time, one of them being RDF, who was like a sort of crusty reggae band. Around that time, 1993, 1994, there was other bands around the time, Meat Beat Manifesto, Back to the Planet, those sort of bands. And I had a knock on the door one day from the bass player from RDF, and they were pretty big at the time. I mean, they were a touring band earning money, releasing records and stuff. And he knocked on my door and said, Spike, do you want to, like, you see me playing drums with their Request sound system, and said, do you want to come and fucking drum for us? And so, I said, that's great, but I want to take like my photographer, a cinema man, Jim Pugh, and Steve Howard, who was doing all the back tapes and stuff. And we kind of formed this band and with Tim Lane from the Pink Diamond Review, which I'm hoping you've researched. Very good band. And DF118 were kind of, we were like a rock industrial outfit. And we were like a proper touring band. It was like, well, you know, when you're that age, when you're like in your mid-20s and you're playing in a fucking band that's getting paid for going around the country, like touring and fucking getting paid for gigs, it's great. It's great. And DF118 was brilliant. But it sort of coincided. It was at the back end of the whole Acid House thing. So everybody was doing the ecstasy thing. And the DF118 thing, unfortunately, got into the harder drug kind of thing, the drug culture and the heroin and the crack cocaine and things like that. So that kind of band imploded, but it sort of sowed the seeds for the later things we were doing in life. But DF118 was a good sort of springboard for what me and Jim were going to do. Yeah.
Real quick, you were doing visuals for the band, right? Can you explain a little bit more about how you were doing that?
okay, imagine 10 televisions put on a stage.
Yeah. Like the big CRT, like the big blocks.
Yeah, proper big televisions. And they were so fucking heavy, man. And I would set them all up. And
how would you play the video?
Videos, you can see them. But and I would have I'd have two VHS players, and a VHS distributor, and and so what I would do is I'd have one video doing this or one video doing that, and then I'd just like switch between
and
them.
You did you take this on tour, or was this just for a handful of gigs?
I had to take them all in, all these televisions. And I didn't get any help.
Did you have your own van? Is that how did you carry those around?
Oh no, we managed to get a bit of space in the van.
It's a fucking van. You got to remember, right? We were an industrial punk fucking funk band in the back of a van doing all the cliches of a heavy rock band, but with instead of a load of Marshall stacks, we had a bunch of TVs in the back of the van.
Did your band ever...
That's just the way...
Did your band ever put out any like vinyl or CDs or tapes?
No. No,
there is a video about
in heroin addicts.
Right. Well, now
I did.
Let's.
No, I'm sorry.
So there's the thing, and it, especially within that kind of a scene, and around that time period, you know, drugs definitely run rampant in musician circles. I mean, in every genre and every time period. Unfortunately, it does sound like the band imploded. And from what you've told me previously, there was a period of about 5 years that you and Scott here didn't talk because you were off somewhere. You want to talk about that?
I was trying to cut a bit. Like, let me, before we go on, I find the whole drug thing really, really fucking boring. But it's part of the story, yeah. So I'll tell it, you know. That's just the way it is, you know. So, but I'll go on, yeah. We fell out of contact because of that. We split up and it started between mates that you love and stuff, you know. We just
But you tried to get your life together, yeah. And you went to rehab, is that right?
Yeah.
And that was like 97.
Yeah. And we did in our own way. So yeah, and we're proud of that. You know, we came through it. So
Scott, cool. When I talked to you about this time period, you told me that you had spent that time digging through your collection for loops.
Yeah, I found some too. Spike is the man that puts the loops together.
Right, no, this is before you guys got together. I want to talk more about you and what you were doing during this time period while, you know, you guys were separated. Like 97 to before the mashup thing. This is before we even get into mashup.
Before the mashup thing.
That's an interesting variation. I'd like to know too. DJing. That's what you're doing.
I was DJing disco records.
All right. What clubs were you DJing at?
The After Dark. The Purple Turtle.
Yeah.
Just clubs.
And again, just, you know, loving your vinyl records. Now, this being said, let's start to get into this, as far as the whole mashup creation thing. When did you first hear mashups? Before you started making them, what is it that turned you on, Scott? Where did you hear it? What did you hear? Who helped you?
Ah, right. Okay. I was sitting at work rendering a huge video file, and bored, and found GYBO and saw that they were posting up all these mashups. And I immediately messaged Spike and said, Spike, check this fucking place out. And then it was then decided that we needed to take over.
So, okay, it sounds like...
Is that right, Spike?
Huh?
Is that right? We had to, we decided that we needed
take
to
over take GYBO.
That over and take...
I'll tell you what happened for me. So I went through that period where I had to clean up my act, right? So I'd left DF and I tried a couple of things. I went to Newcastle College and I tried to I went to a couple of classes where I wanted to teach drums as a teacher perspective, but that didn't work out. And so I left DF, I came back. And I went kind of stagnant. I was quite, you know, when you're trying to clean up, it's quite, you know, you don't need music and stuff in your life. But when I got myself clean, I was ready for a new challenge and to do something new. And that's where Jim came back into it and said, right, you know, there's this little gap in, he didn't say gap in the fucking bourgeois thing. Say, okay, so Jim came back and said, there's this little scene happening, which was the mashup thing. And, I was quite interested. I was very interested. So, yeah, Jim sort of kick-started me again from having a period of, like, you know, I was doing nothing musically.
Right.
Nothing.
Now, this being said...
However, we had no tools to make this stuff with, you know? And
here we
then
go.
Luckily, Jim was working at a place called Sounds Good, which was a CD duplication plant at the time. And so he had access to lots of technological stuff at the time. And one of them was this thing called Adobe Audition. This is way predecessor Ableton and SoundForge and, you know, all those other bloody platforms that you can make music with these days. And so he gave me a copy of Adobe Audition and it gave us the tools to not only make the stuff that we love, but, you know, if we rewind 10 years when we were trying to mix Frank Sinatra with all these disco beats, which we couldn't do with all these turntables, we could actually do with computers.
So No Request great. Sound System became Pilchard. And you were doing in the 80s, but you were like, shit, now we can actually seamlessly put all of this together.
Pretty much.
Why did we call it Pilchard anyway?
We called it Pilchard because my mate Steve Howard, who was in DFM8 and the Request Sound System, which, remember, we used to rib him. Because Steve Howard was like a big DJ in Brighton. He said... And we said, well, what tune? And like back in those days, it was white labels or bands you'd never heard of. And we made a joke saying, oh, have you heard this track by the Pilchards? And he said, no.
Ah, yeah, I'll remember.
That was right. And that was how the name Pilchard got
formed. So it started with a little bit of fake hype of like, here's this band.
A little bit of fake, yeah.
Again, you go...
Fake hype is always...
So here's a question for you. When you were on GYBO, Scott, and you first started seeing all this stuff, who were the mashup artists that were making the tracks that really excited you at that time? Say 2002, the things that you were like, man, we really have to do this. We have to. And from what you had told me previously, this is almost like a competition. You saw this and you were like, we have to conquer this. We have to take these people down.
What's his name?
Okay.
Ozimoso. Pomdita was always in there. And what's his name? Spike will know.
Done proofing. That's a good one.
done proven, and
We're talking about something that was like 18 years ago. So I completely understand.
Yeah, I know. What's his name? Spike. You know.
The raver guy.
The raver guy.
There's a lot.
Are you talking about maybe Aggro
right
1?
Aggro 1, yes. Aggro 1 was good. It was like really... Oh, hang on.
Yeah, I tell you what, right? If Jim can't remember GYBO, I fucking can't say.
No worries, no worries. It's kind of funny.
I'll be right back.
Oh, you do you. You do you, Scott. So, Tony... tell me about like some of your memories from GYBO, as far as like there were always challenges where people would be like, you know, we're putting together this compilation, or here is this, you know, themed album. How did
but be honest with you, Jim was more like in control of the whole GYBO thing. It didn't really interest me that much. From what I remember of GYBO is what excited me is that they created a scene, like an underground scene. The mashup scene was like fresh. It was exciting, like people stealing samples and like making a whole new genre. That excited me. And there was like, this was before Facebook, remember? Before MySpace. And you created your own. Mixlesey had done a brilliant job of getting all these geeks together. But that's the one thing I didn't like about GYBO, was that it was so geeky. It was like so anal. And people were like, pick apart these tracks, you know, which I found a little bit much, really.
Yeah, he was using the handle Pilchard, and you were using a handle called Bus Putty. Right. Yeah, because this might be one of the reasons why a lot of people were like they thought Pilchard was just Scott Cairo, because you were a little bit more hands off with all of that. Right. Now, that being said, right. Right. How about this? It looks like we might have lost Scott Cairo. We'll bring him back the moment he answers the phone again. So here I'm going to just move Tony over full screen. Tony, are you there? All right.
Yeah, great. I'm here.
Yeah, when we lost Scott, we lost Tony's audio. I had to mute, Scott's audio because
something.
There's a doubling up of the audio. It's a backstage tricks, everyone. So to get more into it, so the funny thing is that both you and Scott have this relationship where it's like you believe that he is the strong man of Pilchard. He believes that you're the strong man of Pilchard. I mean, you guys work really well together because from what you've told me, he was the idea man and you were the mastermind, the master mixer behind the whole thing.
Uh Right, okay, so one thing you ought to know about Jim is that he's got absolutely no sense of rhythm for a start. So, but he's got an insane brain, you know. So we just drew on each other's strengths and, like, insecurities and stuff. So, yeah, we had a little blend going on. And I remember, you know, so, yeah, I'd never, ever take fucking full credit for any Pilchard tracks. I mean, I put them together, but... Me, whenever I put a track together, I would run. Literally, we used to live lost from each other. I would make a track, and I would get it on my cassette and run, or a CD, and run, fucking like that, like a madman, all the way to Jim's, because I knew I wanted to play it to him. How excited! I said, "Jim, fucking this is this. I got it." And then, like, put it on the CD player, and then we just roll about laughing. And that was like. The components to making a good Pilchard track was A, it was fucking heavy and hard, and B, it made you fucking laugh, and C, you know, it was just like insane. And we had that little chemistry going, and that was lovely. It's beautiful. That's just the way we worked.
It's gorgeous. Yeah, was it your tracks? I think you guys really stood out in your crowd. There were a handful of people like LV15, who else, like Agro One and stuff, that were doing like higher tempo drum and bass style, mashups. And I mean, some of your mashups, they top out at like 185 BPM, which is fantastic. Yeah. But again, completely understandable when you're like taking like, you know, soft lounge from like the 70s and 60s. And, you know, pairing it together, it's like, you know, there are these really slow speeds of like, you know, like 60 and 90 beats per minute. And so you're double timing on top of that. Yeah. And the thing is that you're also so densely layered in a lot of your mashups. It wasn't nowadays when you get like a mash mix, it's more of a mash medley where they're taking like, you know, all the top hits and they're smashing them together and like kind of stringing them in a stars on 45 kind of a way. Whereas in that early period, when you looked at things like, you know, yourselves and looked at places, people like Soul Wax, they're digging in and finding old Italo disco. They're finding these just rare children's records. And they're taking bits and pieces of popular music through the 20th century and current and making this, it's almost like a remix. Like you see current producers like Rhythm Scholar kind of do the same thing with some of their mashups. But yeah, it's a reason why I think a lot of people still love a lot of your old classic tracks. Specifically, I know one that is really, really popular was Clap Stereo. Can you tell me about Clap Stereo?
Oh, hey, there's Jim.
Is Jim back? Well, he isn't. He's here. Let's see if I can get him to show back up on the screen. There. Oh, here he is. He's a little small, but we can get him. So anyway, while I fix Scott, why don't you tell me about Clap Stereo?
Okay. Anything that preceded Clap Stereo, we were sort of tickling away, trying to get our foot in the door with the whole GYBO crowd. Kitchen sink at stuff, you know. Clap Throw, that was the ultimate track for us, where we threw absolutely everything at it. I mean, a lot of people were doing A to B stuff at that time. And with Clap Throw, you had, oh, fucking hell, we had, oh, God, what are they called? Ursula 1000.
Right.
Had the song, which is the Bell Stars, and then you had Triple Sob, which was Chris Morris, who was like a great English satirical. And then you had British, then you had Dr. Dre going on, so you had all these elements going on. You had hip hop. You had easy listening, lounge going on and film soundtrack, which was like all the elements that me and Jim loved when we were growing up. It's pretty much condensed into one track. And Clapsthrow was the one track that actually broke on GYBO, and people started to take Pilchard seriously. Like, oh, right, these boys can fucking do their thing, you know? And it made me laugh. I mean, he took the whole GYBO thing really, really seriously. But to me, we were always doing great stuff, but that was the one that kind of put us on the map, should we
Let
say.
Me give the audience a little taste of Clap Stereo here on Masters of MASH. Just a little taste of Clap Stereo by Pilchard. It's got elements of Shirley Ellis, Britney Spears, Pier Lindeen music, Chris Morris, Ursula 1000, and Nerd all smashed together into that very joyful and raucous track. Scott, can you tell me a little bit about who put that video together? Oh, Scott, I do believe your mic is muted. See if you can unmute your mic. So, Tony, do you know anything about the video for that track?
Yeah, I do actually. So the guy with the clown hair and everything. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. So the story has it that we made the track and it kind of blew up on GYBO. And we got an email one day back in the days of email, and it was this guy, this transvestite from San Francisco on the gay scene, the tranny scene, and he said, "Look, guys, we've heard this track that you've done. Would you mind if I do a video to it?" He said, "We're playing it around all the clubs in New York and Manhattan, and they're loving it." And we said, "Yeah, absolutely." And they made this fucking insane video with the split screen, just him.
Right, Scott.
And we didn't even know who he was. I had no idea who he was.
Scott, I think we have your audio. Are you there? Scott, can you say something? No, I'm just getting a buzz now. Anyway, we'll continue on with this interview with Pilchard. Scott, if anything, it's good to see you. On screen. Just keep working on that and see what you can do about getting some audio going there. So one other thing that was big on GYBO was actually your first track. Initially, you guys had told me that your first track was Don't Roll Me Down, Tiger. But you just recently sent me something saying that it was actually a different track. Do you remember what your first track was that you guys put together?
A track.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I can hear you now, Scott. So, Tony, tell me about Chairman of the Bad.
Chairman of the Bad?
First ever Pilchard track. Whey! Rock and roll. So, the first ever track. It was a mixture of, we took a loop from the Wise Guys, ooh la la, you know, ooh la la, c'est ça, ba ba ba. We took a loop from there and then mixed it. And the Sub Syndicate, Couscous, the bass line. And with Adobe Audition, we could filter out the bass line. So we did the bass line from this heavy-duty dub track. And then we took a little bit of Ministry, just one fix, like bow, 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 bow. And then we took a little bit of Iggy Pop. I'm the chairman of the board. Bow, bow, I'm bored. I'm bored. Michael Jackson. I'm bad. Yeah. I'm bad. You know it. I'm bad. You know I'm bad. I'm bad. And then the fucking cherry on the cake, which was so Pilchard, like this laid down the gauntlet, was that you fucking cunt. You calling me a cunt?
You fucking cunt.
You fucking cunt. And I swear to you, the original version of Chairman of the Bad was the dub syndicate bass line with Derek and Clive going, you calling me a cunt, cunt, you fucking cunt. And that was it.
I always thought that was a little bit over the top, actually.
You thought it was a little over the top?
No. That was the staple, like, kitchen sink approach of Pilchard, really. That was it. That was our fucking moment. And I tell you what, I remember making the tune that day, and I had the but then before you could get a cappella from anywhere. And you had to, was literally about four a cappellas online available. And one of them was Michael Jackson's I'm Bad. And there was like three others. I don't know what they were, but it was before a cappellas for you. And we got Michael Jackson's I'm Bad. And the first time I dropped his a cappella into it, fucking, I lost the whole session. And it never worked ever since. The version that's out there, the track, it's like, all right, it's okay. It's okay.
I'm bad. So,
you know, I'm bad.
So, Scott. Tell me about Grandmaster Flash versus April March.
No, I'm gonna have to pass you over to.
All right, well, Tony, tell me.
April March.
Like fucking like the prime. Okay, so April March and
it was the track was called what? It was Grand March or April Master or what was it called?
Everywhere. So it was Grandmaster Flash with April March. And we loved April March. They were like I think they were from England actually, but they like did this sort of loungy style sort of thing that we loved, like Bell and Sebastian, right. That sort of thing. So we nicked the groove from there, and then we love Scott Walker.
No,
well, do you know Scott Walker? You know, the sun ain't gonna shine anymore.
Okay, yeah, I'm familiar with the track. Yeah.
But so it's sort of basically built around that. So, it was based around a lounge rhythm with a rap on it. Again, around that sort of time. You couldn't get a cappellas. So you had to, like, in audition, you had to know the guitar and the whatever, the keyboards, and you had to kind of cobble together a kind of vocal to put onto a drum track, a different drum track. And that was our kind of second other track, ever track.
You were also talking about how, you know,
this is where it was
these tools didn't have pitch correction, really. And, you know, you were having to use
Oh, thank you for reminding me. I tell you what, I fucking hate pitch correction. And you know what? The thing is that because we did know how to pitch correct, so you get an idea in your head, yeah, that's going to work with that. and then you put it together, and if it didn't work, you binned it. You fucking threw it in. So you had to work a little bit harder because I didn't, or me and Jim didn't have like the technical ability. If it's on through pitch correction or fucking auto-tune, it was literally a fucking case of blag and just try different things until it works. And but same goes with like rhythms and stuff like that, because the samples with Adobe Edition didn't fucking work. You know, it's like, blah, 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 and then you shoehorn it in and it fucking worked.
That sounds like a really physical process.
It's a very physical process.
Now, Scott, were you there for any of this creation? Were you just passing an idea over to him and letting him struggle with this software? Or were you, like, guys together, like, having a drink, like, saying, yo, put this here, do this, whatever?
I would tell him what to do. And most of the time he'd say, you could go fuck yourself. But a lot of the time, they say, yeah, that's going to work. And then
and it's funny,
be a Pilchard. That's why we were.
Well, Scott,
I think
Scott, Tony had said something earlier.
He didn't have any technical ability, but he was never fucking like, and that's how we worked. Because we were fucking telekinetic. Is that the word? We just knew how to put a track.
Well, you guys had worked together for so long, and you were friends for so long.
Put that together, Spike. We just knew. We knew. Our brains connected. That's the way we worked. We just knew what worked.
Hey, Scott. Scott.
Yeah.
So tell me real quick. As Tony was saying with the whole GYBO thing, GYBO wasn't his thing. It was all, you know, too much criticism. It was a little too nerdy for him. You wound up running with that. You wound up kind of being the face of the band, you know, being what most people saw as Pilchard, and actually wound up doing a lot of events with them as just by yourself as Pilchard.
Okay. The whole GYBO thing, because first of all, I don't think they really liked us very much, and that made me want to fucking nail them. And I knew that within Spike, I had a weapon of mass destruction. And I knew that we had a weapon of mass destruction in Pilchard. And so we unleashed it. And it worked. Spike, did it not work?
Yeah, of course it fucking works.
What we did, we just unleashed the whole fucking Pilchard thing.
Just like fucking had insane ideas and put them together. And we didn't give a fuck. We put out, I swear to you, we killed enough for about everybody put out a track. And within 2 days, we could knock the track and bang, knock it down. Knock it down.
Bang. We were the fucking ninjas.
Scott.
Two boys. We'll get to it in a minute.
Yeah, no,
we'll
for sure. I'm about to move on to that now. But
No one on the scene who could
fucking
touch us.
I want to go ahead and address something that you had said to me previously and that you said just now, is that, you know, and I'll go ahead and allay these fears. Most artists, you know, are pretty self-conscious about their work. Hi, Joe.
Hi.
Just wanted to say hello. So Scott, let's talk about this for a second, because I know artists are self-conscious about their work, And especially when you're doing stuff that's like so visceral and in your face, you know, you already pretty much expect that people are going to kind of like have a pissy attitude towards it anyway. So I can see why you might have felt that McSleazy might not have liked you, but I'll let you know in the course of my my research in this, I actually got a chance to speak with Grant about you, and here's his quote. Are you ready for this?
Grant.
So here's Grant. He says, "Pilchard, stand-up guy, one of the backbone of GYBO. Long-term, fun contributor with a strong party ethic. Never took himself seriously."
Well, he could have said that at the fucking time, couldn't he?
So the key is, I mean, again, like, understand that less people, I've always found in the world that less people dislike you than you think. Especially being a self-conscious artist. So at least put those fears to rest.
Where's McSleazy now?
He's still doing it. He's actually relaunched his mashup career, if not for just the moment. He's relaunched GYBO, he's good. He's good. I may or may not be able to say that he's going to be a future guest on this program. So that's a rumor, folks.
I tell you, I love McSleazy, right? He had a little moment in time. Yeah, and he put together the GYBO thing, and I love him for that. I love him, but I didn't like his smash up.
Yeah.
At least you guys are honest. That's really what it is. So when you talk about like being like,
back, I love you, man. And I love the whole GYBO scene, but we weren't very good at mashups. Sorry, bud.
I have to say, this is to be expected from a duo who wanted to eviscerate anyone that was in their path when it came to you know, being the top of the GYBO, you know, pile. Now you said that you had someone that you specifically had sought out to destroy. And that was the Who Boys. Can you tell me about that and where that came from, that competition?
The Who Boys? Fuck the Who Boys.
Fuck.
Boy, yeah, fucking history.
Hey, listen, right? So we were casually like going along, making our mashups. You know, we were like Burt Bacharach of our hero, but banging out the number one hits. Buff, buff, buff. Don't roll me down. Buff, buff, buff. Clap throat, buh, 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 you know, the next one, buh, and like, I fucking love it. Doris, hey, bang, bang, bang. And then the Who Boys came along. It's like, oh shit, they are fucking good. They're fucking, and they fucking do original stuff as well. And they do harmonies. Oh my God, we're in fucking trouble. So we had to put the scars to what they're doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then, fucking clubbing with these boys, they ain't invited up to our fucking up to their studio to do these fucking nights out.
No, wait. Before you did that, let me just pull you back just a second, because first of all, you had, I'm assuming you guys had a rivalry online on GYBO before you met in person, right?
Yeah.
Where you're like kind of like cursing at each other, kind of like this.
No, actually, on GYBO, we had a mutual respect online. Bored with everything that was going on with GYBO. It was like, oh my God, these guys are putting out tunes, and like they were just put that we just
so
very lovely
when
lovely.
You say that there were things on GYBO that you didn't like, what, and that were boring, and that, you know, this caught your attention, what was the stuff that was boring to you? What was the stuff that like you weren't feeling as far as like GYBO? And
like anything. There's a couple of things. Right? There's a couple of things. Sorry, I wouldn't say everything, and I'm not being. I sound so arrogant, but I didn't like anything.
But no, but what were the reasons you didn't like it? Was it too poppy? Was it too?
It was just shit. It's just, I don't know.
It was shit.
It's just like, I don't know. It's just, it was just like up his own ass. It was just like everyone's taking themselves so seriously. It was like, come on, guys, all you're doing is taking somebody else's music and mix it with a bit of that. And be, come on, don't you take yourself so seriously.
And how is what you were doing different in that moment?
Best.
I'll tell you what I thought. The whole thing with the GYBO, I thought, oh my God, there's so much creativity going on there. I thought if you could take this attitude that you got in your mind with taking other people's stuff, but use your own stuff and fucking do it, you know, this would be brilliant. So I really wanted GYBO to like forget about mashing up other people's stuff, do your own stuff. And to a certain extent, there was a couple of people doing it, but the Who Boys were the only people taking the elements and the beauty and the essence of Mashup and making something new. And that's what excited me.
To your point,
about the Who Boys.
To back up your point, I definitely want to talk about some of your work and some of the early work again of like bands like Soul Wax and their stuff with Too Many DJs.
Yeah.
Is that they would work on these mashups and they would do these remixes, if you will, that were more like songs. They had a more song aesthetic and structure. You know, some of your mashups would have choruses of multiple songs kind of interplaying with one another, where only those small elements would come out. Example, in that Clap Stereo track that we heard, like you only had little tiny snippets of Britney Spears that were just like the dee dee dee, you know, in the track. And so you're using these tracks as like instruments, if you will, and you're building this in this song kind of structure, which I really appreciate. And I agree that it gives a different sound and it definitely makes you stand out in a different category within the mashup scene. One of the things that I'm trying to do with the show when talking to all of these different producers is I'm trying to look at the different styles of mashups that actually exist. You know, you have your AB, which is just an acapella over the instrumental, but then you have, you know, and again, you have like people nowadays doing like mash medleys where it's like, here's all the top songs of the year. And it's like, it goes from this song to that song, to this song, to that song. But again, with what you were doing, it's like, you start to get into interesting, like, you know, here's, you know, the certain numbers of bars, a pre-chorus, you know, an extended break here. Like you were really kind of not pushing the boundaries, but actually like just treating the mashups more like songwriting at the time. So I can see that. Now, when you finally did get together with the Who Boys, the story that you had told me on Sunday was that you guys hadn't met them and they had invited you to be on their podcast. Is that right? Can you tell me that story?
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. So we built up a kind of, which was really, really cool. We go back to that. I mean, we're going to the future to go backwards. But yeah, the Who Boys were a couple of people that we really related to. And the way they spoke and just the things that they were mashing up and the tunes they were trying to do. And the way that they talked about our tunes and the excitement we got from their tunes, that kind of built up. And then they were doing this thing called monthly podcast.
Mm-hmm.
And it involved Mark Rathbull and Giles Hearn from the Who Boys and Brian Coleman from the Who Boys and a couple of other people. And they did this monthly podcast and they would like play a selection of mashups. And they'd do this chat, and nobody was doing that at that time. Nobody was doing that.
No one.
And it was really fucking exciting. And they fucking invited me and Jim up. And me and Jim, I remember at the time, because there was this little friendly rivalry going on between us and the Who Boys, we thought when we turned up in London, they were going to...
What does that mean? Like, beat you up?
No, probably like fucking like... do us over. So me and Jim got this bloke called X Bouncer, who was like a to him, look, mate, we're going up to London to do this interview. Can you come up with us? Because if we meet him in the tube station, we're not that fucking hard. Can you come and fucking knock him out? So we turned up in London with this big fucking bouncer who like a big ex-bouncer bloke, military guy, with me and Jim, and we were turned up in Shoreditch on this tube station and met Mark and Giles from the Who Boys. Like, how you doing? All right. And then we went back to their place, and then we did the interview with the podcast. And ex-bouncer, he was a mashup artist. He did a version of I Could Be So Good For You, which was the, I don't know. And we just hit it off from then. And a beautiful story. And if the Mark, if the Who Boys are listening, they'll know what I'm talking about.
Something?
Yeah, please.
Go on. When I did the Mash Bash in Germany, Shiggy was my bouncer.
Now we're jumping way to 2009 here. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if you know about Shiggy.
I've met her. Like, yeah, I've DJed a booty event with her.
Fucking kung fu, and the whole night. With Thomas Bovin.
So we'll get to that story here in
there
a minute. I want to go back to 2005 when you guys decided before GYBO did it, you guys decided to put do Pilchard's Pirate and do a pirate boat mashup expedition. Can you tell me about that?
Oh, fuck it. Are you
yeah.
The pirate. Okay, the pirate boat. My boss had a canal boat, and he let me borrow it, and we took it down to the Reading Festival with some speakers, and we're blasting out mashups. We had Tim Backer. What was the other guy's name? You know the guy.
Oh, V15 was there, I think.
Shiggy, we had the whole fucking lot. It's like a mashup boat.
Yeah, you guys were flying a cassette and crossbones pirate flag, and you had a ton of CDs plastered to all the windows of the boat. I've seen the pictures. Tim from Radio Clash has a lot of these things on his Flickr account. Again, Tim, and when you were talking earlier about like nobody was doing a podcast like that with the Who Boys, Tim was definitely doing his podcast, but I think I know what you mean by, you know, the Who Boys were literally not just having, music, but were on the regular, almost every episode, having a different mashup artist over to like have a conversation and kind of like do an interview.
Yeah, remember this shit, yeah. Yeah, they had somebody to interview every
now,
month.
How did you guys wind up meeting Tim Backup, a.k.a. Instamatic, a.k.a. DJ No-No, a.k.a., you know...
Oh, now there's a story.
Tim Backup. You tell him.
Tim. He organised a night in, oh, was it Brixton? I can't remember. Somewhere. Shoreditch, maybe. Me and Pilchard. And the Who Boys to play back to back in this little fucking basement in London. And we turned up. I remember me and Jim were fucking late as usual. We turned up. He said, Jim, fucking Spike, you're fucking, oh, you've ruined the whole fucking night, you fucking, oh, you just like, done this. Completely kicked off at us. Anyway, so we went on stage, and then it suddenly turned into this war. We didn't even realize what was going on. So we had Pilchard at one side, and we had on the other side with bass speakers over there. It was almost like a dub reggae, like Josh Shaka's sound system, like dub from the 70s. And we were throwing tracks at each other. So So the Who Boys were put on a track, a mashup. We were put on just fuck. And it just got so insane and so intense. And then Brian fucking Coleman from the Who Boys at one point picked up this bass amp and threw it like through the fucking, threw it through the audience and tried to fucking hit me and Jim. It got so fucking violent. oh my God. And Tim Backer was completely so pissed off with me and us Pilchard and the Who Boys. Because it turned into a fucking dub war. But that's what we were doing. That we were so emotional. And they had so many great tunes. We had so many great tunes. And then we continued to do a, like, we had about a year where we were like playing all the time. It was fucking kicking off. It was great. And there was the same rivalry going on. Who's got the best tunes? The Who Boys. Who's got the best tunes? Pilchard. Fucking. And it was havoc. It was fucking great. It was like tribal football hooliganism, but on the dance floor. Way. You know, everyone was doing, but fucking having it. And like, we were like having this rush of energy between us. It was brilliant. Loved it.
So that being said, trying to do research on a lot of, not just you guys, but on a lot of mashup artists in this time and period of history, is really spotty, because again, there are no official record labels that, like, you know, archive your stuff. There's you know, different web hosts where the website's gone down, and like maybe or maybe not the internet archive is like taking a snapshot of it, stuff like that. I'm assuming that the show that you're talking about is was called Mutant. It was around Halloween. It was you guys, the Who Boys, Instamatic, and Phil and Dog. Does that sound right, or was it before that?
Oh, Phil and Dog.
Oh, Phil and Dog was the last show, yeah.
You won't find any of our stuff online because it wasn't saved.
Well, I don't know. Saved. I mean, I was able to find a lot of stuff. I mean, again, Tim did a really good job. Instamatic there at Radio Clash. With his podcast, wound up playing a lot of your stuff, wound up taking a lot of pictures at a lot of those events that you guys wound up, you know, doing, as well as, you know, other people interviewing you guys, bits and pieces here and there. Like, it definitely, you can still find stuff. More importantly, when we get back to those early times, we need to talk about, well, first of all, that Who Boys podcast was episode 13. The Pilchard Cometh is the name of the episode. So you guys can go look that up if you want to go listen to yourselves. Their show started in August of 2006. But around that same time period, you guys, Booty, were the first ones, or they picked up one of your tracks on their, let's see if I can find out from my notes here. Yeah, you made the October 2006 top 10 with your song Fox Problems, and it went on.
Oh my!
You got
God.
On Booty for October 2006, and you guys made the
really?
Best of Booty compilation that year. So you were one of the top tracks of the year according to Booty in 2006. Now, Tony, can you tell me a little bit more about that track that got you so much acclaim in the U.S. called Fox Problems?
Well, Fox Problems, was that? That was Jimi Hendrix with Jimmy Bohorn. Right.
That was the only one that, what's his name like?
Hey, I tell you what. I tell you, there was a little selection of tracks from that year. I don't know, we went through a little purple patch. They were just happening, but yeah, I've got fond memories of that track. But questions behind it, I don't know how it came together. It's a beautiful track, isn't it?
It got you a lot of acclaim. So now, again, like, you know, you guys got to play with Phil and Dog of, you know, the Milo's Dr. Pressure bootleg fame, and more importantly, the song Gay Muppet Bar, if you remember that their track. But you guys also had a Menomina kind of Muppet track. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah. Oh, God, what was that track called? It was called Mack 'em Up It.
Yeah.
That was it.
Mack 'em Up It.
In true traditional Pilchard style, it was the Macarena. And it was... was that it, Jim? Fuck. I don't know how that...
Macarena and... Macarena.
Yeah. Mack 'em Up It was the Doors, the Macarena, and the Muppets.
That's the story behind that was the gig that we were talking about a little while ago with Tim Backer with the Who Boys and Pilchard throwing tunes at each other. And when we dropped Mack 'em Up It, the Who Boys said, "Ah shit, no, we can't beat the slot. We can't do it. We can't do it. That's it." And that was our little moment, you know, because the Who Boys couldn't fucking take us down with that one. That moment.
Get into some of this comedy and these you know, old childhood themes, you guys also had a thing for Woody Woodpecker. Can you tell me where that came from?
Don't tell him about
Woody Woodpecker. I need to know.
Listen, this is really unfair. When you try and dissect our tunes and why we put things in, because it loses its charm. I don't know why that happened. You know, it just happened. It works.
You know why it happened, Spike.
It just works, man.
Scott, it sounds like...
And it's so obvious...
You know what happened.
It's so obvious that Lily Allen fucking ripped off Sandy Shaw. It's so
obvious.
Of course.
Oh, Jesus. It's just so fucking obvious, Spike.
It's so obvious.
Okay, here's a question for you. Meep, meep.
That's so obvious, yeah.
Fill me in, guys. I'm lost. Meep, meep. Tell me about that. What?
Meep, meep. There's no story, man. It just works. You can't dissect it. We're not on classic albums, Big Freud, Dark Side of the Moon. You know, it just works. It just works.
Let me
find
the
meat. Now, around 2006, you guys had a song called Jack the Monkey, right?
Oh, yeah.
And in 2006, Boris VJ Brewski made a video for it. Yeah, I mean, yeah. How did you guys wind up with them? It's just, you know, something on GYBO that they ask you, you ask them.
Again, that was back in the day when with GYBO and that sort of thing going on, you get emails occasionally and say, "Look, would you mind if we did a video to this track?" And Brewski was one of these people. Brewski was cool.
Scott,
Same
with any Same input with into your relationship with VJ Brewski or Boris?
Brewski is a master of the cut and splice.
And then along with people with names very similar to that, and someone who's a giant fan of yours to the point where they've made numerous tribute, mixes of you guys, would be Bud the Wiser.
Bud the Wiser!
No, Bud the Wiser's just...
Yeah, how long have you known Bud the Wiser? When did you guys...
What are you talking about? He's our mate. He's beautiful. I love him. Good lad.
How long you guys... Scott, how long you known him? So you grew up in the same, like, he was from Reading? Or where you met him in person?
No. When we first started getting involved with GYBO, one of the people was him that liked us, and because he liked us, we liked him, and so we supported him, and so we let him do whatever the fuck he wanted to our stuff. Is that right, Spike?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he's a good lad.
So I'm seeing a picture here coming out, and that is that, you know, Bud the Wiser's part of your mates. You've got the Who Boys are in your corner. You know, Tim back up, aka Instamatic, Tim B, he was in your corner. Let's see, who else was? Shiggy was part of your crew for a while. Who else would you say?
Oh, Shiggy's definitely on my crew. Shiggy's on my crew. What's his name? Mike Cartel, he's on our crew.
Now, that being said, Mike was doing the bastard events. When did you guys first do a bastard event?
Oh, right, Jim, this is your turn.
I think it's probably best not to talk about our bastard.
Was there a problem? Did you guys get into a fight with Mike? Or?
No. We just completely fucked it up.
In what way? How did you fuck it up?
Well, we did a bit. We didn't know how to work the
okay,
CD
well,
players.
You know, technology is a hurdle for sure. But so that was the one time, because I know that you wound up doing a West of Bastard much later.
Ah, the West of Bastard was a good one.
15, yeah.
And so tell me about that experience.
We went to Bristol.
That's what I remember.
With the idiots.
With the idiots?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
We had to pick them up from the airport. And we had to hold a sign up saying idiots. Eventually got
them. Story. Somebody flew in from fucking another country to play at our gig.
Aberdeen.
With us.
Aberdeen.
Jesus.
They flew in from Aberdeen. Anyway, so we shipped him into the fucking gig. We did the gig. It was quite good ish. And then we had to go home in the car, and the car broke down on the motorway. And
I remember that. You broke down on the motorway, you couldn't get home. And it cost us. You broke down in the car called Kylie. And it cost us about fucking $8,000 or something to get you home.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's terrifying. And also.
Most terrifying.
Costly.
Yeah.
So.
The best standing in the airport with the idiots.
That's definitely a highlight. Now, that being said, you guys wound up getting invited later to an event organized by Holestar. And if you can tell me a little bit about Holestar, it was the fifth birthday party for GYBO, and they had it on a boat, so they called it the GYBOAT party.
Oh.
Now, a lot of names. Like, you turn around and you said you were originally, you know, influenced by Aussie Miso, and he was there. Like, you know, Mark Vidler, Go Home Productions was there. Like some really big names were at this party. Tell me who was there, and tell me, you know, what it was like. You showed up. What happened?
Oh, man.
You fell down the stairs?
I fell down the stairs.
Like, with Jim, with a pint of lager at the top of the stairs, and me at the bottom, and he, like, flew down the stairs on his ass, and this pint of beer pretty much went... And landed in my hand. That's my only abiding memory of that party.
Now what? Yeah, go ahead.
I had a fight with someone, didn't I?
You did have a fight with someone, yeah. I'll tell you what, I'll be honest with you. I think this was coming towards the end of GYBO. And I think we need, all right, if we're going to talk about Mashup and Pilchard and stuff, get this conversation back on track at this time. At the party on the boat, the whole mashup theme was going a bit weird. It was all getting a bit fucking cliched, but also Facebook was turning up. Now, when Facebook turned up, GYBO kind of went off the radar. Mick Sleazy didn't know what to do with it. Am I telling the truth there? And when Facebook, and because GYBO felt like a little underground, didn't it? Come on, let's be honest, guys.
Yeah.
It felt like a little underground. It felt like this is our music. These are our team. These are our friends. And this was beautiful. But when Facebook came along, technology, whatever you want to call it, then GYBO could not, Mashup could not survive under that those circumstances. We were fighting around amongst sharks. And it was dying. It was dying.
Well, so that being said, you guys still wound up doing quite a number of events and putting out a lot, definitely, you know, a decent amount of work. And I know that GYBO eventually, they moved around, but eventually did wind up closing in 2012. So they, yeah.
Was
that's,
this 2012? Yeah, which would have been.
Yeah, in 2007 is when the boat thing happened. Oh. So that was only 5 years into it. So they still had another 4 or 5 years into them at that point.
Another 5 years to go. But I tell you what, I think personally, with Pilchard and Tony Crackburn, well, we'll move on to Tony Crackburn. With Pilchard, I think we started to lose a little bit of interest. A little bit of interest.
Right. Now, that being said, just to cover like this GYBO party, again, you can go to Tim's website, Radio Clash, find his pictures through all of this, links to his Flickr accounts for all these pictures. But again, organized by Holstar. Had people like the Freelance Hellraiser were there, Aussie Miso, Soundhog, McSleazy, Dunproofen, Pirate Sound System, Cartel Communique, Eve Massacre, Linlow, and the Doctor from Boom Selection. So, I mean, this was quite the premier event as far as like when we talk about like the core people who helped push this scene forward at the time. It's amazing to hear that you got into a fight. Scott, who did you get into a fight with?
Who was it? The story is we were on the boat and there was a guy that I thought, oh, you fucker, you ripped our tune off.
Oh.
And it wasn't the person that ripped our tune off, and he took offense. Punched my fucking lights out. Fortunately, Brian from the Who Boys came up and said, don't you fucking dare. So, the very second you have fighting involved in a bootleg scene is the second it's dead.
Well, again, Scott, I'll point you towards a lot of my other interviews and some of the interviews on Tim's and on John Nelson's page. Was it Some Assembly Required? When you look through all of these stories of mashup producers, it seems from the very moment mashups started being made was the moment that mashup producers started saying that, you know, the scene was dead or that mashups were dead. And here we are 20 years later, with several thousand booty mashup fans tuned into their Twitch channel and millions of mashup fans, you know, on YouTube, smashing the like button on like DJ Cummerbund and Bill McClintock and stuff like that.
Ah.
And but again, I mean, there's still a lot of mashup artists they're getting a lot of likes. Mashups have never died. However, again, I think maybe part of that appeal, and I'm speculating here, is that, you know, it is this such a novel thing. It's such a good, amazing thing that you expect it to like burst up like a flame and go out immediately, be immediately extinguished. So therefore it's like, it's over, it's done. Mashups are dead. Finally, for the first time, for the 50th time, for the millionth time, mashups are dead. But let's get it back into the story here. You guys, it's like 2007. You're starting to like kind of be like, I'm not sure about it. You still wind up doing a couple of things, like you did this 72 challenge on GYBO, which was Pomme de Terre's thing. You wound up doing Tim, was it Radio Clash's 99 Flake compilation. Tell me, Scott, what you specifically pointed me to 99 Flake. What do you have to say about that compilation and what your contribution was?
99 Flake was like a major challenge for me because I knew that Spike wouldn't like it. I was like, we got to do this. We got to do 99 Flake. I don't care what you come up with. Come up with something. And he did. So.
All right. And what track was that?
Oh, fuck me. I don't know. Spike?
Tony, are you there? Tony has walked away from his chair. Well,
I'll look it
up. No, it's okay. So, Tony, I'm getting this.
Right. No, Flake.
What was that?
Oh, yeah, Flake. So, we, around that sort of time. So, after the GYBO. Sorry, yeah. Okay, so after the GYBO, things sort of chilled out a bit, and me and Jim were doing, I can't remember what the sort of brought the whole thing back. I don't know. I've no idea. I've absolutely fucking no idea what Jim.
So let's talk about something for a second, because I mean, Tony, you very specifically, when first talking about getting onto GYBO, it wasn't your scene. You were saying it was too nerdy, people too critical, fuck all this shit. And then Scott, you really were like, I want to be a part of this community. You know, dug your heels in, made a lot of friends, made a lot of connects, wound up doing a lot of shows and wanted to be parts of these things. Now, this time period, it seems like Tony, you know, you're not really wanting to do the Pilchard thing. And then at some point you come out with the Tony Crackburn Orchestra. Tell me about that and where your focus was. Because you were still doing mashups as the Tony Crackburn Orchestra, but what was your audience? Where were you pushing this stuff?
Okay, so Tony Crackburn Orchestra basically I was getting really fucking bored with, like, a mashup. I must be honest with you. Getting really bored with it. I was completely new. I was mixing with the Who Boys who were doing, like, original stuff. So it's like, and they were kind of, and we met through the mashup thing, so we had kind of mutual respect with the mashup scene. I really wanted to do some like original stuff because I'd done drumming, I'd done the diff hop, bombardate stuff. And the Tony Crackburn Orchestra seemed like the sort of natural progression. And I don't know where me and Jim were, like friendship wise at that time. It's like he still wanted to do Pilchard, he still wanted to do mashups. And I think those very, very early Tony Crackburn Orchestra tracks are kind of a sort of signpost into where we were going. It was like, they were fucking heavy. If you got ticked to the first ever Tony Crackburn Orchestra track, it was a mixture of, it was a straight A to B. So we went back to the pure essence of mashup, which was A to B. So we took the fucking Hives, which was hate to say I told you so. And we took that and then we mixed it with fucking Sue Thompson, this beautiful vocal from the 60s. Kick win yourself and so it had all these beautiful harmonies going on with this hard, aggressive fucking backbeat. And Jim got hold of it and did this brilliant production on it. And it was just a straight A to B, which, and the funny thing was, Pilchard never, we always did an A to B, to C to D, to E to F, to G to H to I. Right. First time me and Jim had done an A to B. And that was the first fucking track, the Tony Crackburn Orchestra, Tick Tick Tiger. And it fucking punches you in the face. I remember me and Jim doing it, that one, hours on the fucking production. We were bang, bang, bang. And when we fucking released it, it was like, oh my God, that's what we want to fucking do. That's what we're proud of that track. So proud. And Roadkill, which was fucking rock and roll.
Oh, Roadkill. Fucking hell, yeah.
Roll, your eyes up on the wheel. Bang. With Wolf Mother. It was just... And the Tony Crackburn Orchestra was all about this aggression and fucking... And, yeah, we fucking pulled it off.
I think we pulled it off. What was it? The Roadkill track I handed over to DJ N8, who does Mashups Rock on Booty Mashups Twitch channel. He has said that he's been looking for something almost exactly like that, and he probably will wind up spending it on the channel. That being said, I wanted to give the audience a taste. Here on Masters of Mash, this is the Tony Crackburn Orchestra with Tick Tick Tiger. All right, that was just a taste of Tick Tick Tiger.
Tick Tick Tiger.
Oh. Hey, Scott.
Hey, Scott.
Turn the speaker off. There you go. Excellent.
Okay.
Yeah, just a taste of Tick Tick Tiger here on Masters of Mash, Tony Crackburn's first track that broke through. That being said, you wound up putting out a ton of stuff. But you say that it was kind of like your own thing. But again, when telling that story with Tick Tick Tiger, you're still working with Scott on a lot of these tracks, yeah?
Yeah, we did a whole album. When we did that whole, like, Losing Weight and Pub Debates, we were working on, we done all the Pilchard tracks. So we were trying to move in a direction that was doing original stuff mixing with mashups. So even though Tick Tiger was the pure apotheosis, or whatever, the opposite of like doing original stuff, A to B, we'd never done to an A to B. That was our A to B. And then we did Roadkill and stuff like that. But then we started finding really, really obscure mashups. So we got to a point where if you were doing a mashup, if the sources were so unrecognizable, nobody would fucking have a clue that you were doing a mashup. It almost become your original track, which is what Chemical Brothers and Fatboy Summer and stuff like that would do at the time. They were taking samples that were so like obscure that it might have been your own stuff. And that's what Tony Crackburn was all about, was taking stuff that was so obscure and making really, really original tracks. And that was what I was into at the time.
And you spun that not only into kind of like a compilation / best of Pilchard, again, Losing Weight and Pub Debates was the name of the album that you guys dropped in 2009. But you also had started a new podcast with one of the Who Boys called Front Room, right?
So Pilchard are pretty much died. So I was completely bored with the mashup scene by that at that point. Jim will correct me on this. I think Jim was like still quite into the mashup scene. We did the Tony Crackburn thing. There was drugs going on at the time, and me and Jim weren't getting on very well about stuff. And then I got involved with Giles from the Who Boys, and we did the Front Room thing, which was really, I loved it. It was invigorating. It was like a soap opera with a couple of robots, and we were writing our own script and like doing like the Archers with, we were like taking elements of mashups, but making original tracks and making a storyline and making it like a soap opera and like a series. We made two series with six episodes out of this storyline about two robots living together in a weird fucking world, and it was fucking great. And I was kind of sort of pushing towards doing more original stuff, really. I was getting really, really bored.
I really liked in the Front Room because I got to listen to some of it, that it kind of mirrors what's going on right now, in that it deals with a worldwide virus that is bound to take down humanity, but it's pushed on humanity by by your sister, who turns out to be an android.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
I'm back now.
We're taking elements of the Tony, but Jim fucking hated the front room stuff.
Right. I mean, it doesn't seem like his thing.
Hang on. I was on the first front room.
You were on the first front room.
Yeah, I did.
Involved with the
taking the
first
back off things.
First draft of front room, but I think he quickly got bored of it.
I had a bit of an issue with his current girlfriend.
Aha. Uh-huh. Well, you know, interpersonal drama is always a thing for sure. You know, it's something that bands go through, whether that be, you know, not liking each other's significant others and or just simply drugs. All kinds of things can get in the way of that thing. But the key is that the story of Pilchard, from what I've been able to see, is really a story of you guys have known each other pretty much your entire lives, up to, you know, at least early teens, and have worked together to make some amazing music. Now, this being said, in 2009, and Scott, this is probably more your story, while Tony is off doing front room, you decide to do the international Mash Bash and with Shiggy and LV15 and Thomas Bolvin and whatnot. Tell me how that started. You said that there was something that you and your girlfriend specifically set out to do with international Mash Bash. What was that?
Okay. We set out to not get drunk. So we hooked up in our hotel and we thought, well, we're going to have to do a bit of getting drunk. So we went to the local supermarket and bought a bottle of wine and thought, right, we'll drink the bottle of wine and then we'll have a sleep. And then we'll go to the club. Everything was going fucking great. We drunk the bottle of wine, had a sleep, woke up all sober, boom, 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 let's go. Next thing I do is I hear the Who Boys on the phone. Ah, we're in a bar. Okay, so we go down to the bar where the Who Boys are, still hoping not to drink anything. And me and Joe are saying, oh, we'll just have a beer. We'll just have a couple of beers or something because we don't want to DJ this thing drunk. The bar's run out of beer. And so the bar says, okay, we'll do €1 vodka, double shots of vodka for €1.
No.
And guess what? Guess what? Me and the Hugh boys, we're just like caning fucking double vodkas. And it just got really fucking messy.
Now, this was before your DJ set or was this after your DJ set?
Before. However, we pulled it off.
Yeah, I've seen the pictures, and there's actually a recording of your set that is on Tim's channel, or I think it's Tim's. I need to double check that link. But there's definitely a recording of that set that you did and you successfully did. But from what I understand is once you were done with that set. And once Shiggy was done doing her bathroom set, because, again, this was a two-day event, and the second stage was actually a tiled men's bathroom that was this big.
Yes, it was.
Really, really tiny.
It was. Shiggy was playing in the toilet. It was about, I don't know, this big. And really, like having it
right,
and and me and Joe were saying, oh, can we go home now? And Shiggy carried me home with got me to bed, and I bought Thomas Bavin breakfast. And Shiggy, I think I bought Shiggy breakfast. I can't remember.
Well, I'll tell you.
But that was a good one.
I'll tell you, you guys wind up still doing events past that. You wind up inviting Shiggy to the Glade Festival, to DJ at the Glade Festival.
Yeah, it's the Glade. Yeah, we did the Glade roller disco.
That sounds like a lot of fun. Roller discos are great. I'm going to read a little bit of something from something you guys posted in 2011 when you posted up your album. Was it Losing Weight in Pub Debates? It says this. Back in 2003, when the mashup scene was practically unheard of, Pilchard was all over it like a particularly annoying and prolific rash. Having spent years DJing at clubs and house parties, Tony Crackburn and Scott Cairo were bored of hearing the same old tunes being mixed together. In a brave attempt to shake things up a bit, Tony and Scott would fill their record bags with music from such greats as The Carpenters, Doris Day and the Osmonds, along with a selection of unidentified lounge music and anything else that came to hand, really. The DJ duo would then attempt to mix these records using nothing but a basic mixer and a pair of record decks with other beats such as dub raga, breakbeat, and acid house. But trying to shoehorn music together in this way was always going to end in tears, and the disastrous results normally cleared the dance floor in seconds. Thankfully, however, Tony and Scott eventually blagged themselves some music software. At last, they could create new music and their distinctive mix-and-match style, and Pilchard took their place in the mashup Hall of Fame with the help of Bootleggers forum site GYBO. Here is the definitive Pilchard collection produced between 2003 and 2008. Enjoy Losing Weight and Pub Debates. Now, that being said, you say that it's nowhere to be found online. Is there any chance of this getting put back up maybe in the compilation section of Tim's bootleg archive?
I think it is.
Is it there already?
Put it, man.
If not,
well, I can put it up.
If not, I need to find you guys and get that put back up so that everybody can go ahead and grab that. Again, this is Tony Crackburn Orchestra and Pilchard tracks from 2003 to 2008. As we all know, GYBO ended finally in 2012. You know, there were other groups such as Mashup Charts and Mashup City started in 2007. You know, what the Mashup, Mashup Town, Mash Dex. Were you guys parts, or Scott, were you in on any of those groups?
No.
No?
No, I avoided them.
I tell you what, Jim, after this period, Jim kind of took over the whole Pilchard thing moving forward. So any further questions with Pilchard after 2006, probably needs to go with Jim.
Right. Now we only have a minute left in this show. So I definitely want to give props to your side project, Tony, which is Dismembered Phone Booth, which is members of you and the Who. It's you and the Who Boys, basically. Mark Rathmel, Giles Hearn, Brian Coleman.
Yeah.
Who is from Colorado or living in Colorado right now. You're mixing originals with mashups.
Yeah.
And then...
No. We're not mixing originals with mashups.
You're doing straight up originals. Okay, on that one. I'm sorry. One last thing before we go.
Rocking.
Supposedly, there was a rumor that you were going to be on Stiff Records in 2013.
No.
But that you spent all your money that you were managed by the Hell's Angels. Is this complete?
Don't bring up the Hells Angels.
Well, that being said, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Masters of Mash. Ladies and gentlemen, Pilchard, UK mashup duo. Any chance of you guys ever making music again together?
No.
Really, no.
Yeah.
Anyway, go ahead and check out Booty Mashup. The Adriana's show mashup listening party is starting right now. I'm gonna leave you guys here with a little bit of Kids React to Crumple Bangers, which features a track from Pilchard. Anyway, thank you so much, guys.
Cheers, guys.
Crumble Bangers.